trying to convert people. And, well, I'm happy that he's not here today. However, if he is, don't worry. On my agenda today, we want to disappoint him. So let us go at once to our message. Our message this morning is entitled, What Can Wash Away My Sin? Let us bow our heads as I pray. My Father who is in heaven, we would like to hear you speaking to us now. I'm grateful for the privilege and the value of sharing your word. May you speak to your church. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
What can wash away my sin? But perhaps before we get to the washing away of sin, I want us to first touch on how we fall into sin. Then we can wash away the sin. Amen? Amen. Let us go at once to the book of 2 Samuel chapter 11. Second Samuel chapter 11. When we are there, may we please say amen. Are we all there? The Bible says, and it came to pass after the year was expired, and the time when kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel. And they destroyed the children of Ammon and besieged Rabbah. But David carried him at Jerusalem. So we are introduced here to a time in Bible time which seemed as a very important time. Actually, I would say people prepared for this time. I thought that it was a time when kings go forth to battle. And so when this time comes, the king David, he sends Joab. Joab was the chief of his captive. He sends Joab to the battle. He sends him with his servants, and he sends him with all Israel. So you can see that this was actually a mega event which people in those days would look forward to. However, the Bible records that David stayed behind. He missed his sin. And so before we even get to the sin of David, what we find here is that before he sinned, he did not eventually just fall into sin, but it started somewhere. So it started when David found himself at a place where he was not supposed to be, at the time when he was not supposed to be there. And similarly with us, we don't just eventually stay. It also begins when we find ourselves in places where we are not supposed to be, at times when we are not supposed to be there. Perhaps let me come closer to the church and say, could it be that it started when other students were studying in the library, but you were on someone's hands? Or while other students were sleeping in their rooms, and you were on someone's chest?
You cannot say that.
So this shows us that actually it started somewhere. I was having a conversation with my mother on one occasion, and I was just telling her of maybe the precautions or the safety of how I would want to spend less time with people of the opposite during late hours of the night. And she was saying to me, you should not be deceived. People do not sleep only at night, even during the day. People sleep. And I believed her. So could it be that also when other students perhaps were attending their lectures, I was busy cuddling with someone in the place?
Oh,
to speak to the ladies. But maybe let me just ask a question in passing. Don't answer it. There are so many nurses on campus. What are you doing here? Anyway, let us continue reading our chapter. We are now going to verse 2, 2 Samuel chapter 11. And it came to pass in an eventide that David arose from off his bed and walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof he saw a woman washing herself. And the woman was very beautiful to look upon. So while everyone is in battle, fighting, we are told that they were destroying the children of Ammon, they were, you know, besieging those towns, they were busy. David is at home, taking it easy. He's just lazing around. He's not doing anything as much. He's just eating, he's sleeping, he's waking up, he's walking around. He's just lazing around. So it so happens that he decides to walk to the balcony. And as he's walking in the balcony, he sees a woman there taking a shower. Right. And the way the Bible describes that he saw this woman, I do not think that he believed and he just continued with what he was doing. He looked at the woman. Actually, the look that he gave this woman is equivalent to the one that Jesus mentions in Matthew chapter 5:28 when he says, "But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her has committed adultery with her already in his heart." The brothers would understand this look. Brothers, are we together? So this is the kind of look that perhaps if we are not together, I can try and demonstrate a look. But perhaps the look that David gave this woman was equivalent to that look when it is spring. And the ladies are begging their leggings in their crop tops.
Please, man.
And the brother is just walking also like David.
Please, man.
Minding his own business. And the lady passes by. Inflames in her leggings and crop tops. And catches the attention of the brother. And all of a sudden, the brother is like, "My goodness." I want to believe that it might have been that similar look that David was giving them. We are told that according to Matthew chapter 5, what Jesus is telling, what Jesus is speaking about there, that actually when David did this, or when David looked at the woman in this way, he had already sinned in his heart. But as if that was not enough, he didn't stop there. Let us read the verse 3. And David sent and inquired after the woman. And one said, "Is not this Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite?" Verse 4. And David sent messengers and took her, and she came in unto him, and he lived with her, for she was purified from her uncleanness. And she returned unto her home. Verse 5. And the woman conceived and sent and told David and said, I am with child. So as if it was not enough that he had already sinned in his heart, he went further to put his thoughts into action. So now he wanted the real thing. So he went on to take the woman and to sleep with her. Then the king David, the man of God, sinned and he fell into sin. But perhaps not really much on his sin. God did show him his sin, and he repented. And I love actually David's repentance, because when God shows him his sin, he did not be quick to find an excuse. In fact, I mean, he could have said, but God, the woman was naked. I mean, what, she was naked, but he did not do that, as we would today and say, "Esh, my husband, when I got to her home, she was naked. There was nothing I could do. It was just her waiting for me." No, but David, in actual sense, David hated his sin. He actually wished he had never stayed behind when people were going to war. He wished that he had never took a walk to the balcony. He hated his sin. And that is genuine repentance. You know, sometimes we say we have repented, right? But then when we are just sitting and we remember our past sin, we do not look at it with disgust. Instead, we fantasize and we say, if we were given an opportunity to speak out loud, I'm sure we would say, But David hates his sin. He hates when he sees the sin and he sees what he has done to the Lord. He actually hates the sin. And that is genuine repentance. David understood his condition. He understood what he had done and where he was, to the extent that he cried out, "Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be white as snow." He saw how filthy he was. He saw the sinner that he was at that condition, such that all that he desired in his heart was just to be clean. He just desired his sin to be washed away. And so he cried out in his prayer, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." So David understood that the only way he could have his sin washed away was by the means that God had set, by the precious blood of the Lamb. And perhaps like David, you are sitting here this morning and you are saying, "Lord, I understand my condition. And like David, my prayer is, Lord, wash me with hyssop." Or perhaps you are praying the prayer of David this morning. You are saying, "I understand my standing with you, and all I'm asking for this morning, God, is that you might create in me a clean heart." If that is your prayer, I will invite you to stand as I pray. You are saying this morning that, "Lord, I understand my condition. Please wash me." And while I'm making that call, I would like to invite you as well. Everyone who has given their life to Jesus, I would like to invite you to the table which reminds us of what Jesus did for us, which reminds us of the sacrifice that Jesus did for us in the cross, and which reminds us of his blood, which only can wash away our sin. And as you are giving your life to Jesus now, and you are asking Jesus to wash you and to